This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network. I'm not afraid, to take a stand.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. So glad that you could join us today. If you want to give us a call at all during the show, the numbers to do so are as follow. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show, or you can catch us on BTC Flow Channel 612. That's BTC Flow Channel 612. We have in recent times been exposed to, observed, at least seen images, a video of, heard and read things related to some very serious violence, women in particular. And this area of gender-based violence is, has always been an issue, has been an issue becoming even more prominent of late, and is now being very closely monitored and even actioned by any number of governmental and non-governmental entities. Only recently, I think we were told that a fair number of even instances of sexual abuse against women brought before the courts have a substantial percentage of them, I think it was 30% of them that are dropped in due course because of delays, et cetera, further exacerbating this issue of violence against women, but gender violence in particular, more generally, is an issue. And I have some very special guests today that will be talking to us about some efforts being made to address this gender-based violence issue. And I'm happy to have with us today some guests from the U.S. Embassy, in particular, Mr. Todd Sargent, who's the political officer in the U.S. Embassy here in the Bahamas, who will be along with Kendra Bowe, who has been working in this area and benefiting from some support from the embassy along this line. And also Alicia Wallace, who is a part of the Equality Bahamas effort surrounding this particular issue. One, welcome to Z Live, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon, thank you.
Mr. Sargent, let me start with you. The U.S. Embassy has been supporting and addressing this issue of gender-based violence. Talk to us about it and why the embassy sees this as an issue to be tackled.
Well, thank you so much for having me on, and it's great to be with Alicia and Kendra this afternoon as well. Look, your conversation is well-timed. I mean, and you framed it well. We've seen troubling, you know, news lately. You know, we're in the midst of 16 days of activism against gender-based violence, which this year runs from November 25th through December 10th. And, you know, but our U.S. government efforts and the efforts of civil society organizations and activists is, you know, it's year long, as it should be. You know, for the U.S. government, preventing and responding to all forms of gender-based violence is a cornerstone of our commitment to promoting democracy and advancing human rights and furthering gender equality. As a matter of fact, you know, our Secretary of State, who's, you know, the equivalent of the foreign minister, has a special office, Global Women's Issues, and that office has a mandate to promote the rights and empowerment of women and girls through our U.S. policy. And so, so what does that look like on the ground here? You know, I can talk about our efforts globally, but here in the Bahamas, you know, we've issued a grant to the Pan-American Development Foundation to do some work up on Abaco. You know, this was an opportunity for us to do a little bit of outreach outside of New Providence. And so Pan-American Development Foundation, in conjunction with the Bahamian chapter of Caribbean Women in Leadership, they're going to be working up in Abaco on efforts to help combat gender-based violence there. You know, we have supported here in the Bahamas, we hope to support the efforts of local groups like Equality Bahamas, like Zonta, the Bahamas Crisis Center, and our sanctuary. You know, these groups work on these issues year round, as well as civil society to explore possible synergies. You know, one of your guests this afternoon participated in one of our U.S. government exchange programs. And as such, she's an alumna of one of our programs and was able to access additional funding from the U.S. government. It's called the Alumni Engagement Innovation Fund. And it's available for alumni of our programs, like Fulbright. You might have heard of Fulbright or International Visitor Leadership Program and or Youth Ambassadors or YLI. And these, you know, alumni can submit grants, and that's what Kendra Bo did. And I'm sure she'll talk more about what she's been doing. But those are just some examples, Zhivargo, of what, you know, we at the embassy do and have done to try to in our joint effort to combat gender-based violence.
Now, I'm going to speak with Kendra and Alicia in a little while, but we almost have a kind of perfect storm for agitating a gender violence situation, because with the Dorian and the displacements that had happened, the economic challenges, you're putting individuals in a very difficult set of social and economic circumstances, so that where there might have been conflict or irritations before, they're now having to be dealt with in the context of a very deprived economic and a very difficult social situation. Then on top of that, we get the pandemic zooming in and almost forcing people to be closer to each other in environments where it's economically difficult and socially hard and so forth. And it wouldn't be surprising in that circumstance that, as I think I heard, there have been even more complaints of violence, gender-based violence, et cetera, especially in relation to domestic households.
Well, you're exactly right. I mean, this is what we hear when we talk to, you know, Dr. Patterson, when we talk to Alicia Wallace and other activists, that those two events, Dorian and COVID-19, have really exacerbated a problem that was already intolerable. I mean, you know, when we go back to 2016, we hear about this report about the Bahamas having the highest number of recorded rapes in the Caribbean. So it's already been a problem here. It's a global problem. Let me be, you know, fair about that. But sure. There's no denying that here in the Bahamas, it's been a problem. And, when we're talking about gender-based violence, and I know Alicia could probably define it much better than me, but we're not just talking about physical violence or rape or incest. We're also talking about, you know, forms of harassment. The definition is actually quite wide and diverse as well. But you're exactly right. I mean, we hear the same thing that you're hearing, that these, you know, events of, you know, these crises are just exacerbating the issue. And you described it right. I mean, people are in more close quarters. It's harder to go out. It's harder to find other, safe spaces. But I do, you know, I appreciate the rhetoric that we hear from the Bahamian government. It's bipartisan. The prime minister says, look, we need to reset. And I think these are his words. He said, reset our mindsets and our attitudes. And he's right. And then the opposition leader says, we're not where we need to be yet. He said, we need to change the way in which men and women negotiate relationships. And I think it's right. These are words, you know. I think it's important for us to have, some action. We can talk more about that. But I'm encouraged to hear, at least on the rhetoric side, the leaders here in the...
Kendra, my audience shouldn't be a stranger to them. You've been on the show. It seems to me like you were born to take up hard causes because when we last spoke, we talked about your work with young, troubled men in school and young ladies in school. And now here you are again digging into a very difficult issue and one that we know is real. Tell us about how you came about this and how, through the alumni network, you have been getting some support to do some work in this area.
Yes, thank you so much, Mr. Laing, and hello, Bahamas. And it's such a pleasure to be on here today with the U.S. Embassy representative and Ms. Wallace, and to share on, just like you say, a very hard and difficult topic. So just to backtrack just a little bit, in 2016, I would have been nominated by U.S. Embassy Nassau, and then eventually, I guess, it was successful in being awarded the opportunity to be a part of a very prestigious program, which is a leadership program, something that I will never forget. It was definitely life-changing. And my program was on youth and community conflict resolution. So the training there definitely fits into what we are doing now. And so that was in 2016, and it was about 16 of us from countries around the world. And at the end of that training, we went to about six different countries on that training, stayed in the United States for almost about a month on that training. And so, like I said, it was life-changing. And there were connections that were built with my counterparts from around the world. We formed a WhatsApp group when it was over. We stayed in touch. And Honorable Sane from Kenya, he posted in the group one day, why don't we get together and do something? He said, I know you all are busy doing your own thing, but let's get together and do something. And sure enough, the group came together. It would have been six of us that came together. The project lead is Mr. M. Tima Solwazi out of Trinidad and Tobago. And then it would have been Kenya, Honorable Sane, India, Ritusha, Tiwari, and Sri Lanka, which is Shahar, and Ghana. And we came together, submitted this project to the Alumni Fund, and we were successful. It was awarded through U.S. Embassy Port of Spain, which is where M. Tima Solwazi is from. But we all collaborated in putting the project together. We networked, and we were successful. And so now we are putting on this project that basically is mapping gender-based violence in a cross-country context. And so we're looking at what are the similarities and what are the differences between these three continents, and then seeing what work we can do to really reduce the numbers. And so we've been finding some very interesting information coming forth from the training thus far and the young persons who have been a part of it. And so it's a amazing experience to be a part of.
I think that would be an excellent set of information to have, to see where there are similarities or differences in what is happening in the dynamics of gender-based violence across these various countries. It would be really interesting. So once you, how long do you anticipate doing this until you have some information gathered about what your findings are?
So what we've done so far is we have, for the Bahamas side, of each country had to select about 20 to 25 participants, young persons between the ages of 13 to 20. And what was important for me, because as you said earlier, I work with Challenge Youth. And so I included some of the students from Boys and Girls School, and they were a part of it. And we had a focus group discussion. We had students from UB, students from the Office of the First Spouse, students from some of the high schools like Kefren and New Providence Classical, as well as some of the other schools, C.R. Walker and SAC. And so they were a part of this. And so we were trying to find their views on, and in six areas, we asked them questions. We asked them questions as it related to equality and equity. We asked them questions as it related to home and family life. And then we asked them general questions as it related to gender-based violence itself. And There were similarities regardless of the countries throughout. And then there were some differences because there were certain things that came up that our participants would not have been exposed to, or those in the Caribbean as much as probably those who were in the African, and genital mutilation and things of that nature. But even as was just mentioned in terms of our numbers, in terms of rape, that's something in terms of the Caribbean, we saw similarities between us and Trinidad in that area and what we call certain things versus what they may call it in a different part of the world.
Okay. Well, Alicia, you're no stranger here either. You've been here before. I mostly very early in the show's history, but yours has been a voice out there speaking to the issue of gender equality and these kinds of issues for quite some time. Your impressions and your involvement in this work, please tell us.
Well, Equality Bahamas has been doing this work since 2014, and just kind of seeing how much the conversation has changed over the past few years, hearing more conversations, more people using terminology like gender-based violence, talking more about domestic violence. And we really see our role as keeping the conversation going, engaging people at the community level, and combining that with our advocacy, that we can advocate all we want with the government and use these international mechanisms, but if the people on the ground don't understand them, then we're not able to build that political will. So that community work and building a constituency is really important. So we focused quite a bit on hosting regular events, creating a space for people to come and discuss issues that are of interest to all of us. And during the 16 days campaign, we have been organizing 10 events. So seven have already passed and there are three still coming up. And we've really been having interesting conversations with people, with experts in different fields and from different countries. And it's been really beneficial to get perspectives from people in different regions, because there's so much to learn from people who have different contexts but have some similar issues and who have already started developing and implementing some of their solutions. So we can see what we can replicate, what we can scale, and some of the things that don't work, and also benefit from the conversations that are taking place within other communities and other parts of the world. So we are really working on domesticating international mechanisms like CEDAW, like Bellum Dupara, and trying to make these terms and these documents more accessible and less frightening to people. Because when they hear about the United Nations, people sort of get this idea that it's, you know, some foreign entity that's going to be a threat to sovereignty in the Bahamas, which was not the case. So we're really seeing that this work has to be done at many different levels and in many different ways, focused on public education, community engagement, and providing information and spaces for people to talk and to be able to get, move beyond the issue. We need to be able to define our problems really well, figure out where they're rooted, and start to build solutions together. And in many conversations, unless there's a specific goal to do it, we just don't quite get to the point where we start developing solutions. So we're trying to put our focus on that.
My observation, not only about this issue, but about many issues, is that you arrange for activities, forums, seminars, conferences, you are definitely going to get some participation. There's no question about it. But what I find is that unless and until some tragic event happens that shocks us, stuns us, irritates, frustrates, angers us, lots of people are really detached from the issue unless it's really up close at home. And so you get really a very marginal support, a very marginal participation in the events. And so we never really get to spread the information as broadly as we need it to be spread. Because once people actually participate in these, but I'm so glad I came, I'm so glad I have this information, but getting them there, getting them to the information or getting the information to them is always a huge challenge when it comes to doing it through events we organize. Is that an issue you are seeing in your own spaces where you're trying to get this message spread or trying to help people understand what's happening?
Definitely, and exactly what you said. It's hard to get people there, but when they actually get there, they are amazed by the conversations and by the different ways of thinking and the ideas that they're hearing shared. They kind of get inspired. They want to get more involved, but it's the getting them there. And at the beginning of the pandemic, it was a little bit easier because people were at home, they were bored. Some people weren't working. Various things drew people to virtual events. It became a lot easier. You don't have to get dressed up. You don't have to, you know, waste gas, all this kinds of stuff. But now we're at the point where people are getting fatigued by virtual events. So we're in a difficult space, I think, with figuring out how to have these events in a safe way and reach more people. And like you said, these horrific events tend to sort of raise the energy. People have like an emotional reaction. You can sometimes shift them toward action and toward participation. But even that dies down. Yes. If you're not able to capture them right in that moment and draw them in and show them how they can make a difference and not just talk about the problems.
I have a dumb theory about it. And then I'm just going to mention it and then talk about it and the other things you want to talk about. So this is my dumb theory, right? I happen to believe that one of the most underutilized means of getting information to people is the workplace. First of all, if an employer is on board with doing something, that employer can almost create a captive environment for the sharing of much information. If they are prepared to give 30 minutes or 20 minutes or whatever amount of time they would like to give to their employees getting that information. But because generally speaking, when people have to volunteer their time for these things, the brethren and sisters are not going to move from away from the TV or from dealing with the children. But if they have a little bit of an opportunity in that workplace, maybe. That's just my foolish idea. We'll talk about it when we come back from the break. You're listening to C-Live. We're talking to our friends dealing with gender-based violence from the U.S. Embassy and some of their partners in the civic community. We'll be back after this break.
Everybody, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together.
If you like a hearty, meaty burger, the A1 Steakhouse King at Burger King Nassau has it all. Cheese and crispy onions on a sesame seed bun. The only thing that can top this is the tangy flavor of A1 steak sauce. The Steakhouse King is a meat lover's dream. And with an ice cold Pepsi and hot fries, it's all you need to fill your day. Get your A1 Steakhouse King as a combo or part of the new King's Feast only at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Have you taken a look at those investment options yet?
Too busy. Look at today. Workout, breakfast, drop kids at school, back-to-back meetings, dog from the groomer, nails, and that's all before 12. How come you're so chill?
That's because my money is as busy as you.
At RF, we find the best Bahamian and international investments to keep your money busy so you can spend more time focusing on you. Contact us at rfgroup.com to find out more. RF, money at work.
Have a holly jolly Christmas. It's the best time of the year.
The holidays are always a beautiful time with family and friends, and this Christmas ought to be no different, especially since we know that vaccination people from getting serious complications from COVID-19 or even dying. Vaccinations also allow us to protect ourselves and the most vulnerable, like the elderly or persons battling comorbidities like cancer, HIV/AIDS, and chronic illnesses like diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, and kidney disease. This Christmas, let's get back to the things we miss, like being able to visit family and friends, parties and indoor dining at our favorite restaurants, and gatherings to celebrate the new year to come. We can have these moments again by taking the simple step of getting vaccinated and abiding by the safety protocols of wearing masks, hand washing, and social distancing.
Say hello to friends you know and everyone you meet.
Persons wishing to be vaccinated should visit the website vax.gov.bs. The Ministry of Health and Wellness also encourages persons to pay attention to announcements on when a pop-up vaccination center will be hosted near you. This message is brought to you by the Public Hospitals Authority. The Public Hospitals Authority, working together for best quality healthcare.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Come take my hand, We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, just let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to ZLive. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today as we speak with Mr. Todd Sargent, of he's the political officer in the U.S. Embassy. Also, Kendra Bowe, who is a part of the Embassy of NASA State Department Alumni Network. And also, Alicia Wallace, who is a partner with the U.S. Embassy from Equality Bahamas. And we're talking about gender-based violence. And so I just gave you my half a cent thought on how we could utilize workplaces and spaces more effectively to get the message across. Because I just happen to think that people kind of do what their employers suggest, ask, or allow for them to do.
Yes. I think that is so true, Mr. Laing. I think for me, dealing with the youth population, that it would be the same context when we're working with the schools. And so you get the schools to, or to appoint students to be a part of. And so it causes them to have to, in some cases, mandatory be a part of certain programs or educational initiatives such as this. And then certainly reaching out to different groups and stuff like that in the community. So I totally agree in terms of getting them involved. And I just wanted to say, in terms of adding this in, when you talk about when they get in and the information they learn and stuff like that, and then you also mentioned something in terms of change, in terms of something dramatic happening. And that is so in terms of that wider reach and wider span. But one of the things we had, there are three phases to the project. The first one was a focus group discussion that we held in August. The second phase was a 5-day virtual workshop that we just completed in November. And then the next phase will be a global summit that's going to take place next year in April. But in the workshop, we were discussing harmful cultural practices and identifying some of the risk factors in terms of violence against women. And one of the boys said, well, if girls would just follow the rules and wear their school uniforms to their knee or below their knee, they would reduce some of the violence that may occur towards them. And so, of course, some of the young ladies, they, you know, were so quick to respond to him. And it's like, oh, that's not true. It doesn't matter what we wear and what we have on. Nobody caring to harm us in any way. And at the end of that day's training in that workshop, that young man said, you know, y'all said to be open to change. And I can say what I walked away with today is that it doesn't matter in terms of what a young woman is wearing. It doesn't give someone the right to harm them. And so the workshop has been seeing those kinds of positive changes and impacts, in addition to arming them with knowledge of what's not only happening in our country, but across the world, by identifying some of the different harmful cultural practices that other young persons are facing, so that they can have a more universal approach in in what their sister or their brother may be facing in another part of the world.
Mr. Sargent, you are a subject expert on this matter of gender-based violence, and this is an area where you have some focus for the embassy. I was talking to someone, or actually I was listening to someone speak about this issue, and I want to remind that it's gender-based violence. So I'm going to read for you some. Teddy's starting to talk about, women abuse men too. So, you know, but I want to remind the audience that the subject is gender-based. Gender doesn't mean female. Gender means male and female. So it's talking about any violence that's centered on some gender or the other. It just happens. We have to stop being pretentious about this. The fact of the matter is, in the majority of cases that we are aware of, I know anecdotally that I'm aware of, that I've experienced in my life in terms of observation or knowledge, things that are reported on, the violence is against women by men. That's the vast majority of cases. So we shouldn't pretend like there isn't an issue of violence against men too, but not pretend that it's so substantial in relation to what we see against women. But when I was listening to someone speak about this matter, they were indicating that while it is true that the violence gets focused, say, for instance, at women, what we see in the way of violence is really a power issue, because adults abuse children because they are normally weaker, that males abuse women because physically they tend to be not as strong. So we really kind of have this power thing that, and so where a woman is strong or powerful or deemed so enough, a man might be less inclined to so challenge than that. So is this dynamic of power really a thing at play in gender-based violence?
Definitely. It's definitely an issue of power. Oh, go ahead, Todd.
Yeah, I agree. I certainly agree, Alicia. And, you know, this story that Kendra just told about this boy, you know, having, by the end of the day, you know, his attitude had changed. That's fantastic. I mean, and that just shows that she's doing great work. I mean, and you know, when we can approach a situation like this and, you know, come back with arguments that say, what about this, what about that? But we really need to not let those distract from the reality. I mean, for gender-based violence, men are overwhelmingly the perpetrators.
Mm-hmm.
A behavior change is necessary, and it's up to us men to make it happen, to stop our own behavior, to recognize our own tendencies, but also, you know, hold each other accountable. And it isn't the responsibility of women. They're the victims of gender-based violence almost all the time. This includes trans women. So we can't place the burden on the victims. It isn't fair, and it won't lead to sustainable change. But sure, yes, it's a power issue. We zoom out a little bit and we look at how women and men are represented in positions of leadership in the Bahamas, but also in the United States and around the world. You know, this is, you know, expanding the conversation of gender-based violence, you know, because it definitely includes power, and it definitely includes the conversation about better, more equal representation for women in leadership positions, including in politics.
Alicia?
Yes, with this issue of power is so important to delve into, because it's often eclipse. It's the thing that people ignore when it comes to gender-based violence, and really understanding that when we're talking about gender, we're talking about relationships. We're talking about relations between people of different genders. We're talking about the ideas that we have about the way that people are supposed to perform their gender. So you're a man, so you should be doing this, this, and this. And as a woman, you should be doing completely different things. And we had a little bit of a conversation about this, actually a number of conversations in some events last week. We had a conversation for men with just a group of men talking about some of these issues. And whenever we have these conversations, masculinity comes up. What is masculinity? What does it look like? And is it the problem? And we always come down to, you know, masculinity isn't a problem. It's the toxic masculinity
that becomes an issue. This idea that you must be macho, you have to be rough, you can only have a certain number of emotions, you can't have a full range of emotion, there's no crying, there's no hurt, you show no pain, you respond in anger, and lead to violence. These are the things that undergird the issues that exist in the gender space. And in the conversation, of course, about the violence that men experience, it's as though to put the spotlight on women for a moment, even if we're talking about women as victims and women as survivors of very traumatic, horrifying events, there are still people, there are still men who feel like we have to put the attention back on us. What about us? And it's a power thing. Again, why do we have to talk about women? Why do we have to talk about people who are marginalized and who are experiencing vulnerability when I feel like I'm marginalized because I had XYZ experience, and trying to map on individual experiences and realities onto an entire group where we know that the effect is disproportionate on women, on LGBTQ plus people, on people with disabilities, on people in family islands who have less access to services. So we really have to look at this in a more holistic and realistic way.
In fact, you know, I heard a conversation about masculinity and femininity that really changed my perspective on the whole thing, because one of the points that was made was that masculinity is not maleness and femininity is not femaleness, that masculinity and femininity are actually characteristics that are in all of us and that are called upon at different times to do different kinds of things. And so in one environment, it may be more important, and another environment, it may be less important. So for instance, if you, and I've seen this, when I thought about it, I saw it, right? Like, so you're a man and you're with a woman in a household, but you decide that, okay, as a man, you built a house, but this woman, you say, or it actually happens, makes the home. Why? Because they say, well, you know, she drew on her femininity, which is a homemaking virtue, and he drew on his masculinity, which is a home constructing virtue. But if that same man lost his wife and now had children to tend to, he would call on his own femininity more to make of that house a home for his children, because he would take on more virtues required for that nurturing. Not a female virtue, but a virtue that we would describe as feminine. And I thought, you know what? That's very interesting. And you see similarly with women. My mother raised 9 of us as children because for the most part, she had to do it basically alone. And I could tell you, whatever we call masculine, she showed those and demonstrated those virtues because she had to take care of 5 boys and 4 girls. And it wasn't that she was not female, but I knew whatever that masculinity was that makes a home, she demonstrated it. And so sometimes I think we get mixed up with that. And so these guys feel like they have to overcompensate because they might be demonstrating some feminine virtues as in being more nurturing and caring in that kind of way. And then people starting to call them names that makes them think, now I got to overcompensate with my violence, my physical power. And it ends up being that you now resolve your conflicts with somebody by a physical abuse.
Yes. And this is all things that we made up, right? We decided what femininity and masculinity are. And one of the interesting things that came out of the conversation with men, we heard from Lani Saru from Fiji, and he spoke about the change in the Pacific since colonization. And that before colonization, there was a third gender. And you just saw it kind of chipped away at once colonization happened, and they're just starting to reclaim their ideas and their beliefs and traditional values around gender and people's ability to fully express themselves in various ways.
What I'd like to say in response to that, Mr. Laing, is that I think in terms of, it's just the idea that women and girls are the most vulnerable in our society. And what our findings have shown and demonstrated as a result of that, that power that men tend to display, women, there is this idea that there is an entitlement to the female child or to women. And this is coming from, again, what would have come from the data that we would have been putting together. So I want to just list off just a few things that women and girls go through throughout the world that may not be known here to us in the Bahamas, but this is what happens. And so we know about incest rape, breast ironing, where girls' breasts are tied down, an iron plate placed on it, because again, not wanting the young girl to appear too sexual in terms of the growth of a natural body, honor killings, as well as honor rapes. And so in the Asian countries, one of the things would happen if two families are in a dispute, in order to harm you, some of the men from one family would rape the female from another family so that now that tarnishes the family. Sex with daughters. There's an idea in terms of sex with having sex, a father being the first one to have sex with his daughter. Female genital mutilation, that's another, you know, major one, where in some of the African countries, up to 90%+ of the women have to endure this procedure. Some die as a result of it, because it takes place with where literally they're cutting the female in her private area, sometimes even to the point of stitching her together until it's time for her to marry. So there is a sense of entitlement, I feel, when it comes to the female child from men in our society. And I want to share something that came from our own Bahamas Department of Statistics, because a year ago, David Williams and I did a program with 25 offenders who were there for sexual and violent crimes. And one of the things that came across was the fact that not everybody views rape or violence in the same way. One of the men who was there, he would have been charged for raping two women, two young girls. And his thing was, what he did wasn't rape. He said, I didn't go and pull them out of the bush. I didn't grab them from somewhere. He said, they was in my car. They wanted to ride around. They ate my food that I paid for at the fish fry. And as far as he was concerned, there was an entitlement. They owed him something as a result in terms of what he did. And so he didn't view what he did as rape. And so there is a level of awareness that we definitely have to bring people understanding more about this concept in terms of violence, understanding in terms of the need for consent, men and boys to get consent, understanding a woman's right to choose, you know, and things of that nature, and really the protection of our women and girls.
I certainly am not rushing you all off the show. If you have more time and want to spend more time, you're free to spend more time. I do have to take a break, but I also want to ask you to consider, any one of you who can, if you want to stay on for after the news break and continue the conversation, there's so much more to talk about, some text that I think you want to hear, please feel free to do so. But I'm going to take a break, and when we come back, we'll continue our conversation. You can let me know what your availability is. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're talking about gender-based violence with Mr. Todd Sargent of the U.S. Embassy, Alicia Wallace of Equality Bahamas, and Kendra Bow of 10,000 Other Things, including Build Bahamas Youth Leadership Development Program. We'll be back after this break.
Everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together. Storm, whatever weather, cold or warm, just let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Are you on the move? Busy running errands? Do you have so much to do that you don't have a lot of time on your hands? Have you gotten your COVID-19 vaccine yet? Well, if you haven't, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine may be the one for you. And done and fully vaccinated for now. Yes, you only need one jab of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine and you are done. Lower your risk of severe illness and death from COVID-19 by getting vaccinated. This message has been brought to you by the Ministry of Health and this radio station.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Child, Johnny Mo's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pull my phone out, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep. Send pics of the damage, file my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of...
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Do you know you can get your business cards designed and printed for as low as 18 cents a card? If it's a poster you want, you can pay as little as $6 a square foot. If your print needs are short or long run, digital printing, wide format, or print consultation, call the best. Call Print Masters to provide its clients with the highest level of personal, professional service at an affordable price. Our state-of-the-art technology also makes working together efficient and easy. Laminations, business cards, flyers, posters, window and floor decals are just a few of the digitized print services offered at Printmasters.
Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located in the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 302-2361.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let you know that you're not alone. Holler if you feel like you've been down the same
road. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon, rainy. Well, there I am, overcast afternoon. If you want to call us, the numbers to do so are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4793043. Mr. Todd had to leave us for another engagement, and he was only supposed to be here for that period of time that he was. So we thank him from the U.S. Embassy for joining us. I still have with me Alicia Wallace and Kendra Bow. Ladies, I want to maybe let's do this. Let's end this segment by you sharing what other things you might want to share, because I promise you, when we read the text that I'm going to read for you after the news break, we have another kind of conversation. All right. So I don't know if there's anything else you'd like to add at this point.
Yes, I wanted to follow up on two points that Kendra made, one, and you made, one about the workplace and it being a key place to engage in these conversations. I just wanted to raise that we are looking to have the Bahamas ratify the ILO's Convention 190, which is on eliminating violence and harassment in the world of work. And it's a great convention. It's very well written, very clear about what its meaning is, about employers having some responsibility for employees in the office building, but the full workplace. So they're defining the workplace to include your transportation to and from work, anywhere you stay while you're traveling for work, when you're in a hotel for a conference, your devices that you use, the technology that the workplace provides you with, they should be providing some protection. So I think that's really important to raise. And once we ratify that, or we don't even have to ratify it, it could be that some employers, some corporations may decide to adopt it themselves and start to put that into their gender policy and into their human resources manuals. And that creates a space for training and talking to employees about these issues.
That is really something. That's interesting. Very, very, very interesting.
Yes, fascinating, right? And yeah. Kendra also was talking about some of the so-called traditional practices that are taking place in other parts of the world. And it really made me think about some of the things that are happening here that we don't necessarily consider as harmful or we don't think about enough. But you know, we know that we have parents here who are checking their daughter's hymens, you know, and shaming them for having a menstrual cycle, making it difficult for them to talk about things that have happened to them. And then, of course, we have the situation with the missing girls where the general public's reaction is, we don't need to look for her. She's going to come back after the weekend because she's playing big woman, you know, and not realizing that what's happening here is rape.
she's not able to give consent. And we need to be very concerned about what's happening to these young girls. So these are some practices that we have here that we don't often think about, we don't often talk about, but they have a major impact on women and girls, and they contribute to violence.
And on a fundamental, very fundamental level, to talk about our approach to raising our boys and girls. The fact of the matter is, I know it, I've observed it. The way some men are raising their boys, they are gonna create crappy men. And the way some women are raising their boys. There are still women who talk to boys in ways and say, oh boy, don't be no sissy, don't. And so they are in themselves encouraging sometimes the violence that these boys as men or as grown physical persons come to see as the way to deal with life.
Absolutely. We know that that's happening in homes.
Absolutely. And I would, yes, and what I'd like to say in reference to Mr. Laing is that it's so unfortunate, but it is the reality. I know three of my boys, and when I say my boys, you know, I'm talking about just being a part of boys' programs from all different aspects of society in terms of youth programs, and even as you mentioned, the Bahamas Youth Leadership Program. But this one would have been an outreach program that we had at the church, and missing, and these would have been students who had behavioral issues and such, as such, and a few of them were missing for a few weeks, and I was like inquiring, okay, well, where are these set of boys? And it's like, ma'am, it's both. They get sent up to boys. They ain't here, you know. They had a little situation, so you know, the girls didn't want to get into details about what the situation was. But when the boys finally returned, and I was like, okay, what happened, ma'am? What's going on? And it's like, ma'am, Miss Bode, these girls just lie. So 3 to 4 of these young men would have been charged and sent to Simpson Penn for raping a young girl. And I can tell you in their response, there was no remorse. They didn't see anything wrong with it. They did not feel they had done anything wrong. As far as they was concerned, she wanted it. And they thought, hey, these girls just as lie. So when you talk about how we raise our boys, there is a viewpoint in terms of the messaging that is out there that today they still believe, okay, no means yes, you know, and you just need to, you know, treat her rough and this is what she wants. And so we really have to examine these harmful cultural practices, even as Alicia was alluding to it again, in terms of what we have here in the Bahamas
violence. We have a lot of discussion to have. So we're going to have that discussion, but I just want to take a break for news. And when we come back, ladies, we will continue our conversation. You listening to Z Live, I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm here with Ms. Kendra Bow and Alicia Wallace. We're talking about gender-based violence. We'll be back after this break.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Monday afternoon. You can call us today on 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us also on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. Ladies, I'm here with Alicia Wallace and Kendra Bow, and they are discussing with me this gender-based violence issue and the work that they do in support, in partnership with others like the U.S. Embassy, and in the one instance, the embassy, U.S. Embassy in Trinidad. I want to I want to read, I'm just going to read the text, okay? Let's read the text. The text is, this gender-based violence is annoying me. They never admit that women abuse men. I'm done. I'm a woman. No one should hit anyone, but the message I keep hearing is, you never hit a woman. Don't hit my son. So anytime a woman upset or angry, she slaps a man. Lying, there was two women that would always grab my butt when I get to work, always. But people think it was fun. I didn't think it was an expletive fun or like it. But they didn't care. All the commercials only say about men being the abuser. There's an angry person.
Yes, they're very upset. They're very upset.
But I understand the concept. I get that. I get it quite a bit too, as we have the discussion, which is one of the reasons why we have been highlighting more in terms of exposing the harmful cultural practices. And so that would be whether it's a male who is the perpetrator or a female who is the perpetrator. But I think that what people are missing out is something that you alluded to earlier, which is the percentage. Predominantly, it is women and girls, predominantly, according to the statistics, that are the victims of violence and abuse.
And this is also why I brought up, you know, the meaning of gender and the issue with putting people in these boxes. This, you know, people talk about the man box, right? People sort of laugh or brush it off when a man says, oh, this woman touched my backside, like this man is saying. You know, it's sort of taken as, well, you mean you didn't like it? Like, men are supposed to like being objectified. Mm-hmm. And maybe they're not taken seriously if they do try to report it. That is an issue of gender. Mm-hmm. That's an issue of this idea that men are a particular way and they're always supposed to like a certain thing all the time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when things happen in the reverse, it's a problem. We're not saying that we are validating those ideas. What we're saying is that this is disproportionately impacting a certain group of people. And that's why we're focusing on that group of people. And if we really work on gender-based violence and start to tear away at these very old ideas about gender and what men do and what women do that are harming us, we'll be able to stop all of this violence.
Yeah. You know, it is true that a discussion on violence should include a discussion on violence against the child, violence against the male, or violence against the female. But I can't ask people who are focused on a particular, extremely disproportionate issue of violence to not focus on that as an issue because I want to acknowledge a smaller segment of violence taking place. Maybe somebody else can take that cause up, and why we're talking about all the other kinds of violence, but it is necessary given the disproportionate amount of violence against females to emphasize that we have a problem here. And it's a significantly disproportionate problem. And where I find sometimes the hypocrisy among us is when it comes to what happened to slaves, African slaves, nobody says, well, you shouldn't pay attention to what happened to African slaves, when in point of fact, there have been white people who were enslaved. Yeah, there have been, but this particular African slavery was a significantly extensive issue that had a particular disproportionate reality in the scheme of human history. So we pay attention to that. We have a woman's desk at Foreign Affairs. We have a lot of things that we create to focus on something when it becomes a disproportionate issue for our society? AIDS, when it became a huge and significant issue, did it not have a special task force? The crack epidemic, it had a special task force. So whenever something becomes a disproportionate issue, calling undue attention to itself, we normally focus on it. And it's not to say other things aren't important. It's getting out of control and needs to be addressed.
Exactly. Yes. That. And I would like to say that was one of the reasons why, too, we held the program in the Bahamas Department of Corrections, as well as in our boys' school, the Simpson Penn School for Boys, because it was also dealing with the males as well. So it wasn't dealing with it just from the side of you just addressing women. We were addressing gender-based violence in terms of on a where we were dealing with the youth, both male and female side of it, but we're also dealing with the perpetrators and helping to bring about rehabilitation.
Now ladies, let me just
having that.
Yeah, go ahead, sorry.
So, like I said, it was just saying, where are we having that overwhelming numbers and stats coming in and bringing focus to that?
Now, ladies, let me just say now, I have been observant over the last several years. And, the fella alluded to this fact that when women get angry and agitated, like they really don't think nothing of slapping, right? and not only slapping men, but slapping each other and pulling here and fighting and so forth. Are we seeing more physical aggressiveness on the part of women too in our society, or is maybe something like that?
I think we're seeing it in higher numbers because people are so quick to pull out their phones when they see something absurd happening or something shocking happening. But the issue of violence, we definitely have this issue across the board, and we have to be able to connect this to people's home life, to people's childhood, and to corporal punishment, teaching us that this is a physical reaction is appropriate to someone upsetting you, someone doing something wrong, or someone not obeying you. It starts from this young age where we have this reaction, and we're really not taught to work through issues. We're not taught how to argue in respectful ways and using our words. You know, teachers tell children to use their words when they just sort of acting out and not speaking. Mm. And it's also needed for adults. We need to learn how to resolve conflict amongst ourselves. And there are mediators among us, but when there's not a mediator present, we need to know how to de-escalate a situation and have a conversation, or be able to check ourselves and say, you know what, I'm not able to deal with this right now in a sensible way. I need to walk away and we'll have to deal with this at another time.
Now, you know, I have one daughter, and I have sisters, I have a mother, and we already exist in a society where there's a prevalence of violence against women. So we know that's reality. So some of that is being done, a lot of it is being done by, in quote, adult people. So the chances of rectifying some of their attitudes right away is problematic. And one of the reasons why I raised the issue of power, where men physically are stronger than many women and therefore feel no gumption about attacking a woman because he oftentimes feels like he can get away with it anyhow, makes me think that maybe too there needs to be more work done in helping women defend themselves. Am I wrong about that?
I think that is something, yes, that is able to help the situation. But I think a large part of it still comes down to just knowing how to resolve conflict.
I accept that. But here's the reality, though. While you are getting to try to help somebody learn how to resolve an issue, a woman is being attacked. And unless that woman has some defense and some knowledge about how to defend herself, she's still at risk. And so I'm not saying we can't do the one and still do the other. I'm just saying, might not we also think, because I know it's happening in some societies where women are taking the liberty of learning to defend themselves. This is not about learning to defend yourself. learning what you need to do to disarm an attacker.
Yes, there's definitely been an increase in people offering courses, self-defense classes and things like that. And interestingly, it's become a capitalist endeavor because now you see on the market nail polish that if you dip your fingers in your drink, you can see if somebody drugged it and things like that. So we also we need to know how to protect ourselves, but we also need to watch out for where this line is and how much it's moving and how much it's basically costing us money and putting the burden on women to protect ourselves instead of using technology like this nail polish to find ways to provide training and interventions for men, because many, many men and boys can recognize that they have an issue, or parents can see that, oh, my child is going in the wrong direction. How can I get some help? And the go-to for many Bahamian parents is to take them to the police station for them to get scared, right? But that doesn't work. They need real skills that they can take throughout the rest of their lives. And I think we need to put more of our energy on prevention and not focusing as much on innovating and finding ways to tell women and girls who are already on high alert how to be on even higher alert.
It's definitely an issue that is complicated because, like, if you take as an example, my daughter is 19 now, right? Like the human being she's having to contend with now, the man, like what programs can get to them right now? But the best I can do now is put her in control of her own safety. Right?
Yes, and be able to recognize red flags early.
That's right. So now these younger boys, yes, now the training, the effort to try and help them to be better at their relationships with women and dealing with conflicts and so forth, that's another effort. But if you have a 19, 20, 25, 25, 26, 30-year-old daughter, or a sister who is having to deal with 25, 30-year-old, 40-year-old men, what's the likelihood they're going to sit down in any seminar listening to how to deal with conflicts in any great number, as opposed to going to some bar trying to act the fool? So I'm saying that we have to have a two-pronged strategy, perhaps, that looks at the one situation and then try to help the other situation. And yes, it's a new burden on the female, but I always say to my daughter, child, ain't nobody gonna love you and protect you more than you can love and protect yourself.
Yes, what I would like to say to that, Mr. Laing, is it actually the trip that you do annually in terms of to Atlanta and the Civil Rights Museum, and when they show the different things that they would have done in their fight for civil rights, and how everybody had sort of a part and a role to play. And so you had down to children who were young girls who would sing, you had people who would cook, you had persons who would fund the efforts, like they gave money so that if Martin Luther King or other persons got arrested. And so everybody had a part and a role to play in helping this movement come to pass. And I think it's the same thing when it comes to violence in our community as a whole, that everybody has a role to play, and it's people figuring out what part they would play in that. And so for persons who have the skills, you're a martial arts instructor or, a self-defense instructor, whatever the case may be, that may be a cause that person is able to take up to say, okay, you know what, this is how I'm going to contribute back to this cause, that I'm going to help women, girls, or young boys, even for that matter, to learn some basic tools in protecting and defending themselves. And so I think if we look at it holistically as a community and everybody looking at the part to play, like people simply being alert and aware on the street and recognizing when, okay, someone actually is in danger, like a man is holding this young girl against her will. Like we had a few cases about that recently where pedestrians and motorists were alert when they saw a man doing something unseemly and they got involved. And as a result, it prevented, a young girl from being harmed. So I think everybody has to take that stake in this in terms of looking at what they can do to help mitigate the amount of violence we have in our community.
Alicia, in the work that you all do, like how does it start? How does it begin that conversation about this problem of gender-based violence? I mean, where do you start that conversation when you have your forums, when you have your meetings and so forth?
It really depends on who is in the room and which aspect of gender-based violence we're looking at. So we don't often look at it as a one big thing.
I see.
Last year, during the 16 days campaign, we had community consultations where we brought people in to talk about gender-based violence, to break it down, and to come up with a set of policy recommendations for the government to address the issue in the three key areas of prevention, response, and justice. So that was a really interesting space for us to develop a problem statement and then answer some questions. Why does this exist? And why does that happen? And why to start to come up with the ways that we need to respond and using survivor-centered methods. And doing exercises like that really help people to understand the issue a lot deeper, because generally we just have sort of a surface understanding of most things until we really start asking questions and listening to other people ask questions and answer them. So that's one of the things that we do, bring people together to develop solutions. And then, of course, we also look at very specific aspects. So, for example, this evening, our event is reporting on gender-based violence and femicide, where we'll have three journalists, one Bahamian, one British, and one American, talking about the role of the media and how the media actually helps to shape our ideas and our behaviors by the way it reports and the language it uses. So Kendra mentioned earlier, honor killings. The 30th anniversary theme for 16 days is femicide. And we've been focusing on, you know, how do we count these gender-based killings of women? They sort of just get obscured in the number of homicides or murders. And if we don't have a real count, how do we know how pervasive this issue is? And you know, maybe this is why people don't understand why we're talking about gender-based violence so much. So I think the conversation this evening is great for anyone in the media and major consumers of media to understand how your own ideas are shaped by what you're reading in the newspaper, how the headline is phrased. It's just an example of, you know, kind of an avenue to talking about it and understanding a specific aspect of the issue.
Well, I don't know what the male version of femicide is, but I can tell you one thing, we do know that the vast majority of murders that happen in this country happen to young Black males.
Yeah. Most definitely. The difference is that femicide is the intentional killing of a woman because of her sex or gender.
Yeah, exactly.
So the cause is different.
There's an intentional killing of a male too, but it ain't by no female, right? Oftentimes it's by a male.
Right, and not on the basis of gender.
And not on the basis of gender, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Now, I do want to ask you both this question. About the violence issue. When you have had occasion to interact with people involved with the violence, have you found that religious beliefs affect the violence one way or the other?
Now, for us here in the Bahamas, I wouldn't say that that's what I found, but from this particular program, in terms of the GPS and Poor Women's Summit, one of the things we learned, the more so African and Asian countries, that was definitely something. So your religious beliefs did impact in terms of the kind of violence that you carried out. So even back to the honor killings, if you married outside your race, you know, there would be men who would go from the family to actually kill that female based on their religious beliefs. And, you know, other things of that nature, even in terms of some of the men in some of the African countries, down to raping or killing young babies or even young girls. If they are sick, they believe that they can be healed or cured through harming, whether in terms of raping or killing, you know, some of the young girls or even babies. So, you know, the religious beliefs that people have definitely impacts how they, the beliefs in terms of how they, their views towards violence.
The context of the Bahamas, for instance, for me, I would have thought, or I would think that given the predominance of our Judeo-Christian convictions, maybe that would sway us more away from violence. So if we find that that don't make no difference in respect to the violence, then that's another story to be told.
Well, I would say this in reference to that, Mr. Lang, from what I've found just simply in talking with a lot of young persons, there is an overwhelming lack of respect for the church today, because they do not believe that the church pretty much is living up to what it says. And they've seen a lot of double standards. And that's not just the church, but even law enforcement. And I think one of the things is one of the reasons why they take things into their own hands. So when students, for example, got suspended from school and they had to come to the center because they got suspended, and you ask them, okay, well, why didn't you report it? Why didn't you, take it to the senior master, whatever have you? The thing was, they did not believe that those who were in authority would handle the situation. And so they felt they need to handle it themselves. And so I think, again, it speaks to the effectiveness today of the church, as well as in terms of law enforcement, that when there are problems, when there are challenges, do people believe if they take these measures that we have, they will get, the necessary result that they need?
I'm going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my stand.
Rev customers already get more channels, more sports, and more speed. Now, we're giving more Christmas with up to $250,000 in cash and prizes. Sign up or upgrade to Rev Trio to win prizes like rent and mortgage payments, trips to see your favorite sports teams, plus up to $20,000 in our Rev Cash Vault. Want to win more Christmas? Call 601-8992 today and ask for Rev Trio. Rev, you and us together.
I marched the car. The lady run into me, marched the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull out the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Food security is a challenge for many. Now in a pandemic, are unsure of their next meal. Through their Feed 5000 program and a $20,000 donation, AML is working to ensure that everyone has a meal for the holidays, and they're inviting you to help. Now until December 17th, visit any Solomon's, Costrite, Fresh Market, or Domino's in Nassau or Freeport, and Exuma Markets in Georgetown to donate and help feed a family in need this Christmas. No amount is too small. Remember, we're all in this together.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. On this beautiful Monday afternoon, I'm speaking with Alicia Wallace of Equality Bahamas. Kendra Bo is Kendra. You are involved with a number of risk-based social enterprises. But at your core, you worked in the Ministry of Education's system, right? Counseling and the like. I had to
unmute. Sorry.
It's
so
okay.
Yes, at my core, I worked in the Ministry of Education system, dealing with at-risk youth. And then also with the Simpson Penn Foundation for a long time, that was a mentoring program dealing again with at-risk youth. And then, of course, spearheading some youth programs at Bahamas Faith Ministry. So currently, I basically work under the heading of the Rite of Passage Project, which pretty much allows me to promote education awareness, advocacy, and rehabilitation. And so wherever that leads me, whatever program that I may partner with, whatever initiative that is going on, it's really under that, because that's the focus of it, because that is where I saw change come the most, is needed the most, that when you give awareness through education and you teach advocacy tools and become an advocate yourself, you begin to expose things and become a catalyst. So for those who may have been perpetrators of violence and in whichever arena it may have been, just the need to work through counseling in terms of to bring about some rehabilitation, because the youth and family, and you combine that's the foundation in terms of our society. And so we need to always find ways in terms of assisting in that capacity.
I think we have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
A pleasant grab the line.
Hey,
Sparky here. I know sometimes. Well, Mayor, I'm listening to you, but I'm listening also and watching the Intercity. If you could give me a moment here. I don't know if you watch your WhatsApp, your Facebook, your Messenger, but it seems to be a very live and vibrant sex craze in the Caribbean going on now. And I could say especially around Jamaica and the Bahamas and so forth. They're all over WhatsApp and Facebook, women, young women, are exposing their bodies, their sexual acts, openly to the public. These things, one day will come back at them, because you know, with the internet, what you give to the world, you can't get back. The old people tell you that. When their children, their daughters and their granddaughters say, oh, that was Grammy? I can't believe that was Grammy doing that. On WhatsApp, on Facebook, and so forth. And then the younger women today, they would openly tell you, because I don't know, Mr. Laing, if you hang with the inner city, the younger women today would tell you they're looking for older men, because they don't have time for the young boys. The young boys want to be block, thugs, gun runners, dope smokers, alcohol drinkers. And then these fellas and these women go back home from hanging out with older men at night, and their little girlfriend was their little girlfriend. They could beat them half to death. Because now they're jealous because they don't have the money with the married men and the rich men out there in the night giving their girlfriends. So there's a lot of things going on with these nice people from these different organizations are not talking about.
Can I respond to that?
Sure, go ahead.
So I think for me, the focus is really what we're trying to do is, one, raise awareness, like we said, on the issues of violence towards women and girls predominantly. But also, I think it's a matter of teaching people to be responsible for their actions and for their behavior. So the age of consent is 16, right? In terms of a young girl or boy being able to give consent in our country. So whether the young girl is doing something on the internet or through social media or dressing a certain way, it's still the responsibility for a grown man to understand if she's underage, she's underage. And so if she, it doesn't matter in terms of her actions or what she's doing, you as a responsible citizen would say, okay, no, if she's underage, then we're not supposed to touch her. So again, that goes back to victim blaming. That's what persons who would be the victim for the cause of whatever violence happens against them.
And you know, to be fair, because I, you know, you hear this all the time, these women dress provocatively, etc. But if men want to be honest with themselves too, sometimes it don't even take no woman to be provocative, because you generate that arousal in your own mind by imagination. And you see a woman, she happens to be dressed nicely, she's, you know, she's shapely and so forth and so forth, and you conjure up them feelings in your own mind. And so the reality remains the same, as you say, Kendra, that we have an obligation to obey the law, to observe the moral standards in our own consciences and act appropriately and respectfully toward other people, period. And even if she ball naked in front of me, I still have an obligation under the law. If it's a young girl or an adult woman who says, listen, I can be ball naked in front of you. And if I tell you no, no, it's no.
Absolutely. And we need to be talking more about consent. We need to do a better job of sexual education. We need comprehensive sexuality education in all schools, at all age levels, age-appropriate education, curricula. It's really, really necessary. We can't wait until people are in high school or until they're in college or for them to figure it out for themselves or get information from inaccurate sources. And we have to understand that, you know, people have bodily autonomy. People can choose to dress however they want. And no clothing can cause that was already in you. You have the urge to exercise power and control over someone else. And that's something that you need to deal with on your own.
Correct. And so, and I also just wanted to add this. So for a woman who was a nun who was raped, who was fully clothed, did it have to do with the way she was dressed? To a woman who was in the military who was raped, did it have to do with the way that she was dressed?
That's the point that I make, is that right. Let's be real. I mean, you go make this movie in your head that arouses you, and now the person just happens to be an excuse, whether they dress provocatively or not. Because what we do is we don't demonstrate the kind of impulse control that permits us to separate ourselves from mere animals. A dog in heat will hop a female dog in that period, but that dog has no choice in the matter. We say that we are intelligent human beings with the capacity to act in a more higher way than that. And so we can't then turn around and say, because she was born naked, I got turned on, I had to jump up? Seriously?
No. We have to make sure that we don't conflate rape with sex, because rape is not sex and it's not about sex. It's about power and control.
Exactly.
And sex has consent and hopefully is mutual pleasure.
Yeah.
Not for someone to take something from someone else. And even our language about sex in many cases is violent, and it's about, you know, one person benefiting over the other. And we're really steeped in a rape culture.
We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Laing, and good afternoon to your guest.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, there's some excellent points that they are making. But in reference to the consent, the age of consent, at 16 years old, I feel as if the government needs to change that age of consent. I don't know what you all
change it from where to where.
18 years, at least 18 years old.
So it should be higher, you're saying?
Higher, no, oh God, much higher. I'll move it to 25, but you know, I think.
Mind you, there's some ways in which I believe I agree with you.
Yeah, that's 16. I mean, 16 years old. Come on, you know, and I think that's a serious matter that needs to be looked at. And one question, it has something to do with what you're speaking about, but in reference to this sexual offenders list. I heard the minister speak that, say something about it in different areas, like schools will have it when it comes out, right? How do you feel about that happening as opposed to it being made public, the sexual offenders list, the list of persons who are, you know, convicted of that? I'll hang up and I'll listen. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to just respond quickly with the one in terms of the age of consent. I can tell you that one of the participants from girls' school, because that would have been in one of our questionings from the focus group discussion, and she agreed. She felt like the age to vote is 18, but the age to give consent is 16. And so she felt like the age from 16 should go up to 18. And so that is someone who's in our girls' school who's agreeing in terms of the fact that the age should go up. So I just wanted to add that there.
Yeah, my position is that the age for girls to be able to access healthcare needs to be down from 18 to 16 to match the age of consent. And on the issue of the sex offenders registry,
I think there are some issues there that we haven't really talked about. We haven't had much of a public conversation about sex offender registries and how they work. It's just been sort of a reaction. We hear a horrible story and everyone's starting knowing the impact of it and how it changes things, if at all. And the main thing about the sex offender registry is that people are seeing it as some kind of solution, but we need to understand that once someone goes on that list, or when we have someone that we want on the list, something has already happened. We've already failed at prevention. So we really need to focus more on the prevention side of it and focusing on what the survivor needs. The next thing about sex offender registries is that we're in a very small place. So making it public would cause a lot of complications, including research has shown that people actually report less when there's a public sex offender registry, because as you know, we already have high rates of incest and people aren't reporting. People report even less when they think that their uncle or their grandpa or, you know, the parent's brother, whoever, is going to be on this list and this is going to affect them for the rest of their lives. And yes, you have to think about the survivor as well, but this is reality and this is what people think. And people do report less when there's a registry. So that's just one of several things that have to be considered when we're talking about that.
We have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Laing. How are you doing, sir?
Hey, I'm okay.
Good
yourself?
Afternoon. You know, I'm enjoying the conversation, but I would just like to say something. Mr. Laing, while we all agree that the woman have a right to dress however they want to dress, but I'll say this. We need to start also elevating the discussion a bit and asking women in lieu of all this cautious. For example, if I just got paid and I'm walking around with gold chains on and I know a shortcut for me to get home a half hour earlier has the potential to have armed robbers through that shortcut, I'm not going to go through that shortcut counting my money.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same thing when you see women dressing a certain way. Prevention is also better than cure.
That is fair. I tell my daughter the same thing, my friend. That is fair.
But, caller, that's not prevention. And research has proven that that's not a form of prevention. Changing the way that you dress, I'm telling you, no matter what I wear, once I hit public space, someone is going to say something to me or try to touch me. It doesn't matter what I wear.
Well, I mean, that's fine if that's how you want to look at it. But I'm saying I have a daughter.
This is my experience.
Tell my daughter, look, prevention is better than cure. And try be very cautious on how you dress in terms of revealing too much, because I know we have one of the highest, according to you all, we have one of the highest statistics when it comes to rape. So let's ask them to be a little bit more modest. But if you say there's nothing wrong, they could walk around basically naked, fine. That's, you know, but I bear you.
But I'm a father of a daughter, and I have had to say to my daughter too that, you know, in lieu of the fact that, you know, you have these predators out there that, you know, you want to be cautious. But the truth of the matter is, as Alicia is saying, do we even know that in the circumstances of most rape, it was brought upon because somebody was dressed provocatively? Because most rapes, if I'm not mistaken, happen by people who know
who, and that was what I guess.
They went out on dates and stuff like that.
Yes. So intimate partner violence.
Yeah.
So there are different forms of rape. So you have what is known as the marital rape, you have stranger rape, and then you have intimate partner violence. So someone who you know. And in most cases, rape occurs by someone who you know. So it really didn't have to do with the way that the person was dressed. So it had to do with someone already had in their mind to do, how they was viewing this individual. And so this is why prevention and education awareness and all of this is so important, because we have to get to the belief system of individuals as to why they feel entitled to women in this way and why they feel the need to attack women in this way.
Right. I mean, nobody would suggest a woman shouldn't do everything in her power to protect herself, but I agree with Alicia trying to put an undue burden on a woman to be less liberal in a society because a man decides to be as liberal as he wants to be. That don't make a whole lot of sense, even though in the end, you know, you don't want anybody to, again, based on the knowledge we have of how or why rape occur, it ain't because people are dressed provocatively in most instances, as far as I'm aware. We have a call on the line. Yeah, go ahead, caller.
Good afternoon to you, sir. I'm
Yes, good afternoon. We're listening to you.
May I ask you why countries do not agree to put all the ages of their women down when you're permitted to have sex?
Okay, I'm not sure what's happening with your mic, your phone, but you're breaking up. Okay, I think we have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
BTC Business's new smart solutions powered by super fast, reliable broadband, you'll feel like there are more. From website design, development, and digital marketing to promote your business, 24/7 business class support to cloud solutions, security, and more. Multiply your growth today.
Have you taken a look at those investment options yet?
Too busy. Look at today. Workout, breakfast, drop kids at school, back-to-back meetings, dog from the groomer, nails, and that's all before 12. How come you're so chill?
That's because my money is as busy as you.
At RF, we find the best Bahamian and international investments to keep your money busy so you can spend more time focusing on you. Contact us at rfgroup.com to find out more. RF, money at work.
Do you know you can get your business cards designed and printed for as low as 18 cents a card? If it's a poster you want, you can pay as little as $6 a square foot. If your print needs are short or long run, digital printing, wide format, or print consultation, call the best. Call Print Masters. Print Masters' goal is to provide its clients with the highest level of personal, professional service at an affordable price. Our state-of-the-art technology also makes working together efficient and easy. Laminations, business cards, flyers, posters, window and floor decals are just a few of the digitized print services offered at Printmasters.
Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located in the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 302-2361.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back. Welcome back to Z Live, ladies and gentlemen. So glad you could join us. I'm here with Miss Alicia Wallace and Kendra Bow, and we're talking about gender-based violence. Do I still have a call on the line? No? Okay. Ladies, I want to read something for you because it's a perfect example of how people don't listen to what you say. They just listen to what they think they heard, right? It says, you are as confused as your guest if you think the way a woman carries herself has nothing to do with a man's impulses. The Bible admonishes women to dress modestly and men to lust. Responsibility is on both. Firstly, let me say, I don't think anybody on this panel said that a man can't be affected by the way a woman's dresses. I don't think anybody said that, because it was ball naked in front of and most men, or dressed provocatively, I'm sure that it's possible for that man to be aroused. But that has nothing to do with what you do after that, because here you are quoting the Bible. Does the Bible say because a woman gets you aroused that you should go and have sex with her? Does the Bible say that? Or does the Bible say flee youthful lust? How about that scripture? I tell some of y'all before, y'all ain't the only people that read the Bible. Alicia, Kendra?
I think you answered that beautifully.
It's sickening to hear sometimes the nonsense rationale that sensible people give for some of the things they say. We have all kinds of temptation in the world. We got all kinds of food that could promote gluttony. Does that mean you go and eat up everything you have? We got people's money sitting around all the time that we could go and take. Does that mean you go and take it? But okay, oh, because a woman dresses in a very sexy manner, all of a sudden now, we need to tell her, well, do something about that because I can't control what I do next. It is absolutely ridiculous.
Completely. And we see that conversation has been happening for the past few years very loudly in different countries, particularly in the US and in Canada, where in the public schools, the students wear their own clothes. And people complain about the way that girls dress and school administration send these rules. And they tell them this is because the girls are distracting the boys, as though it's the girls' responsibility to make sure that the boys can pay attention the way that they are paying attention in class.
I'd be real with you right now. If a woman is dressed in a very, you know, sexy manner, it is possible that it could be a distraction, but the distraction in her is me.
Right.
It is my attention. I control my attention, right?
Yeah, that's on you.
and I think this is one of the things that's fundamental to the challenges we have in the society that we have to realize. You know, even I say to my sons, because somebody says something to you that angers you, because somebody says something to you that irritates you, recognize that the irritation and the anger is in you. It's in you. And so what happens next is about what you do. Yes, what they did may have been inappropriate and should not have been done, but you can't control that. You can control you. And if you can't control you, you are no better than the animals, because they act impulsively and instinctively. You're supposed to act consciously. Yeah. And any man running around talking about, I couldn't have done this be otherwise, means that when you get before God, God can't charge you with nothing because you didn't have an animal. Absolute nonsense. We have a call on the line.
Yes, hello.
Go ahead, sir. We're listening to you.
Hello, good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm chiming in on the age of consent. I'm in agreement with you that men doesn't have to be aroused by what they see. It could be all in the mind. And in terms of not just the age of consent because of adulthood and children being the responsibility of their parents. But regarding that, we should also promote celibacy. And virginity, that even as somebody mentioned, it doesn't have to be the age of consent being 25, but a person needs to know that they can wait until marriage. So it's a whole, it's an additional discussion, but correctly so that men ought not, or no man or woman, ought not to abuse another one by not being invited, so to speak.
Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate it.
You're welcome.
This text says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. And to your guests, I do believe that the age of consent should be raised to 18 in the U.S. You cannot purchase liquor until the age of 21, and you cannot vote until 18, and you cannot sign a consent for surgery until 18. So how come you are so responsible at age 16 to give consent to this alone cause men to take advantage of young girls? I do think that girls dress too scantily now. It says it does not give a man the right to sexually abuse them. God made us higher than the animals, so we need to act like that, says that individual. We have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Lang. I thought you might not have gotten to my text, but I did send that one in. So since I was on the line, I...
Man, this can't be nice.
Yeah, this nice.
Oh, my goodness, I ain't hear from you in so long. How are you doing?
I know. I'm doing all right, you know, Mr. Laing.
Great.
Yeah, doing all right. But you know, Mr. Laing, honestly, in this society and all the other societies as well, not just ours, we need to have more control. What we need to do is teach young people in the school from a very young age, young women to value their bodies, young men to have respect, and that goes both ways, respect for each other. And this is not taught in some of the homes. So if they get something when they go to school, then in my opinion, I think they would probably act better. But they really need to know the value of their bodies. They need to know what is good from what is not good. What should they be relating to from what they shouldn't be relating to? And this is something that needs to be taught in the schools, just in case you're missing out at home. Because Mr. Laing, that young women and young girls dress too provocatively these days, and that does not, I'm not talking about with men looking at them and desiring them. I'm talking about on the whole, just to be, I don't think you need to show your breath.
Okay. Well, I appreciate you. I appreciate you calling us. We appreciate it. This text, as you put that so well, Mr. Laing, people quote the Bible that satisfies their own ego. Well said, Mr. Laing. Ladies, any other comments you want to make about this while we have this few minutes left?
Well, what I would like to say just in closing on my end is that you spoke about the different work and the things that I'm doing. I remember when I was in Washington as a part of the LP program, and I think he may have been the assistant to Jim Carrey at the time, but he came in and he said, the U.S. government is making this investment around the world because we are expecting you to make change in your own countries. And I took that charge very seriously when I came back, that the U.S. government saw a need to invest in me because they awarded me this opportunity. And now I needed to live up to that investment that they had made. And I needed to find ways to impact change. And so that has been a great motivator in the work that I'm doing. And so I just wanted to thank the U.S. Embassy Nassau for their nomination. I think Christine Gilmore was the name of the person at the time who made the nomination here. But I just want to thank them for that and for the work in terms of that the embassy is doing across the world to impact change. And I think just the last comment on gender-based violence itself is that it's a need to raise awareness. We need to be able to have the discussion about sex and the way we view sex and the way we view sexuality and the way we view women and girls, and then look at the things that we need to change there as a nation.
Alicia?
I welcome everyone to join us for the last three events that we have during the 16 Days of Activism campaign. I'm about to give a website for people to go to, just giving people a chance to get a pen or their phone. It's tiny.cc/go16. So tiny.cc/go16. It has all of the recordings of our previous events. It has the links to register for the three events coming up. And of course, keep in touch, follow. We always have community conversations. We have Women's Wednesdays every first Wednesday of the month. And we keep people informed on what we're advocating for and ways that people can join the force, you know, and be a part of the building of people power.
Well, I thank you very much for joining us today. I appreciate your thoughts on these important matters, and I wish you all the best in your continued advocacy on this important issue of gender-based violence. Let's talk again.
Thank you,
ladies
for having
and
us.
Gentlemen, you've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that Alicia Wallace and Kendra Bow could join us, as well as Mr. Todd Sargent from the U.S. Embassy. And we'll talk to you again tomorrow. Guess what? Nahaja Black is up next.